Dudes, this episode carries an extra warning to let you know that there is a level of dissonance throughout the music and the examples that may not fit with your worldview. But keep an open mind, okay?
Hello, and welcome to the third Purcell Sing the Score on the Trot. And prepare to be ravished, yea, even up into the seventh heaven, by Purcell's exquisite verse anthem, Let Mine Eyes Run Down with Tears. And in a first for Sing the Score, this performance has been specially recorded for the programme by E. Fagiolini. Five solo voices in continuo, and I'm particularly grateful to them all for squeezing this into a rehearsal day for a completely different project. Amazing musicianship to be able to do that, really. Since 1679, Purcell had been organist at Westminster Abbey, one of the best musical jobs in England at the time, and a job generously handed over to him by his mentor and teacher, John Blow. If only all of us knew when the time had come to step down. Purcell had just turned 20 at the time, and in fact had been responsible for tuning the organs at the Abbey since he was 15. On his 18th birthday, he also replaced Matthew Locke at court as composer for the violins, Charles II being very keen on the French style of violin band. Purcell wrote anthems for the choir of Westminster Abbey and the Chapel Royal, with strings and without. The one we're looking at today is without strings, and it's thought to come from 1682, coincidentally the same year as Urge Me No More that we looked at last time. These pieces for voices and organs seem to date from 1680 to 85, and they may have been composed for use in the Chapel Royal during Lent when they didn't use instruments other than the organ. And certainly this text from the Old Testament book of Jeremiah is suitable for Lent.
Let mine eyes run down with tears night and day, and let them not cease. For the virgin daughter of my people is broken with a great breach.
But who is the virgin daughter, and why has she been broken? I'm afraid I don't know, but I know someone who does. Victoria Johnson, a presenter here at York Minster, and she was able to sit me down, very COVID-conscious, of course, and enlighten me.
So Jeremiah was a prophet, that is, he was someone who spoke God's words to the people and then mediated between the people and God. The first section is God speaking through the prophet Jeremiah. God is looking down upon his suffering people and God weeps for them. He calls his people the virgin daughter, or another name for Jerusalem or the people of God. They have been struck down with the sword and with famine. And it is God who is actually crying here. The second section, beginning with Hast thou utterly rejected Judah, is Jeremiah mediating the people's response back to God. Because they are suffering, they think God has abandoned them. Have you rejected us, O God? Are you ignoring us? Then there is an acknowledgement that actually the people haven't been very good at following God's commandments. O God, we're really, really sorry. Then there's a final appeal. Do not forget us, O God. Do not break your promises to us. For you are the one who has made all things, so we will wait for you.
That's really interesting. Thank you.
The piece starts with the prophet's tears literally running down the page.
Let mine eyes run down with tears night and day.
If we put that together with the other lines, just the ones that are singing that lines of tears, we get this wonderful tears down the window effect.
Let mine eyes run.
Did you spot that slightly unusual bit of text underlay in the alto part?
Down with tears night and day.
It's a throwback to sort of 100 years before, the time of Taliesin Byrd, where bringing a syllable in one note early is a good way of drawing attention to an interesting note that might otherwise disappear. Let's now hear those lines of tears gelling with the counterstatement, and let them not cease.
And let them not cease.
Let them not cease. But the passage that follows this is even better. It's one of those Purcell passages that leaves you just open-mouthed in admiration. It's got blue notes, double suspensions, all sorts. And the main theme of it is heard most clearly in the soprano part. But that part is very much the first among equals. It's not just the tune, all the parts are tunes, all the parts are melodic, in a way that contemporary French music, for example, wasn't. But this is Purcell not looking across the channel to France, but back to his forebears the other side of the Civil War, Tompkins and Gibbons, even before then to Talis and Bird, where equal-voiced polyphony was more the sort of thing. And for Tompkins, for Purcell to build up a really rich passage of harmony, he has to create a really solid harmonic frame for that, so that harmonically speaking there's
something to hang on to.
Yeah, a harmonic frame for the dissonance to hang on to. Here is that basic frame provided by voices 1, 3, and 5, and I've just for now suppressed one of the dissonant notes in the alto part so that we can better hear the frame. So we've got our three-voice frame, and now the fun starts. To express the idea of lamenting in this passage, and especially on that word broken, Purcell writes suspensions into the tenor part, but not in a conventional way, no. For the virgin daughter of thy people is broken. So here's now the three-part frame with the addition of that tenor part. Now we add the second part down for the full dissonant effect, both those voices, second soprano and tenor, adding dissonance against that consonant frame. Because this is Sing the Score and we can, let's hear a little bit of that dissonance a little more slowly. The coda to this is that the virgin daughter, Jerusalem, is broken with a very grievous blow. You can see it in the score, and you can hear the violence on that snapped rhythm. With a very grievous blow. But there's violence in the harmony too. A few times in this series, in pieces with voices and continuo, as opposed to a cappella pieces, I've referred to harmonic choices that continuo players have to make when there are no figures telling them what chords to play. And I've argued that simply building chords by using the notes in the vocal line is not necessarily the right thing to do, because you also have to take into account the natural harmonic progression of the harmony as well and ask where that would take you. In those last three bars, we see F naturals, part of the chord of D minor, in the sung lines, while the bass line sits on a long D. But the bass will eventually cadence on a G, because this is a classic perfect cadence, chord 5 leading to chord 1. And chord 5, when leading to chord 1, is always major. You don't go... So if you're serious about recreating Purcell's sound world, surely it makes sense to play D major here too.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Can't believe it took us 22 episodes before we got that one in. The Youth, it's from a film called Airplane, 1980. Look it up. Against my D major... some of the voices sing F natural. D, D. And this is where you'd normally lose confidence and think perhaps that the chord should be D minor after all, so as not to create a clash. Until you see that two of the vocal parts had F sharps against those F naturals all along. So finally, empirical proof of the major minor clash in Purcell. And let's remember though that he does this because he's expressing the violence inherent in the text. It's plain to see in those last few bars, or as we call a few bars in musical terminology, the system.
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system. Shut up! Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help, help, I'm being repressed!
Get out. This is not the same as going looking for major minor dissonance just because you fancy it. And I know some of you do. But dissonance can really elucidate the composer's meaning if you don't suppress it.
Give in to it, boy. Go with it. It's society's crime, not ours.
Get out! We were talking about not suppressing dissonance that is naturally there. Another example is in Monteverdi's two-part Zephyr Ritorna, which we all love. Here's a little bit of Matt Long and Nick Mulroy singing it. The piece is in G major, isn't it? G to G with an F sharp in the key signature. Well, not entirely. There are in fact no sharps in the key signature, which means that theoretically we're in G Mixolydian. Almost G major, but with that flattened seventh. But Monteverdi wants the D accompaniment chord not to fit the mode, but to be major, so he adds a sharp instead of. And this can really have an effect on words like soave, sweet, which is generally sung as. But should really have a sweet dissonance and sound. So let's get Nick and Matt to stop on that chord to really bring out those tangy citrus notes.
Soave.
Get back to the Purcell!
Sorry. I mentioned last week those words of Henry Playford in his posthumous edition of Purcell's songs. And how he referred to Purcell.
Having a peculiar genius to express the energy of English words, whereby he moved the passions of all his auditors.
And I had an email from Bill Hunt, a viol player, thinker about 17th century things, pointing out that the Greek word that energy comes from was of great importance in rhetorical discussions in the 16th and 17th century, referencing Cicero, calling it illumination and actuality, requiring the speaker less to speak the words or to narrate them as to actually exhibit, to show the actual scene. So by the time Playford is talking about Purcell expressing the energy of English words, Bill wonders that it perhaps implies whether Playford is crediting Purcell with creating real character, real scene through his setting of words. Although, of course, any rhetorician and Purcell indeed himself would have been the first to point out that that's only half the job and the rest of it is up to the singers. Which takes us to how our bass and tenor pick up on the words at the beginning of the next section.
If I go forth into the field, then behold the slain with the sword.
And if I enter into the city, then behold
Do you sense that slightly queasy colour on sick at the end there? Purcell only wrote sick, but it's a similar issue. I interpret that G in the bass as G major through the whole bar because it leads more naturally to C, so that the chromatic line is then going to howl through it. Sick. Then there's some choral recitative. And on that word rejected, you can hear both sopranos suspended in the upper voices, rejected by the change of chord in the bass, or maybe they're doing the rejecting. And Jeremiah asks, why hast thou smitten us? And another possible major minor, if anyone's counting by this stage. Why hast thou smitten us? Why hast thou smitten us? Both very dissonant. And there is no healing for us. And feel the plangency on those chords. Now let's hear it a little more slowly. Indeed. Would you like to know how that chord was built and what temperament it would have sounded best in? Or should we all just say, oh, for a bit?
Would you all just grow up, please?
Fair enough. That section concludes, and there's then a four-part chorus, very simply set chords, no polyphony, with nice touches of dissonance on the word iniquity, evilness. It does, in fact, briefly break into counterpoint, perhaps so that the two melodies, the two points, can work against thee on the words against thee. And then one of his signature cadences, with the top two parts sitting a semitone against each other.
Stop it.
The solo voices return, now taking on an even more pleading quality, with awkward intervals expressing the urgency of their need.
Do not, oh, do not disgrace the throne of thy glory.
The sopranos eventually sing this in thirds. The lower voices too, with passing dissonance, ramping up the urgency. Which then, with the sopranos added, gives you this chord. And in context.
Do not disgrace the throne of thy glory. Do not disgrace the throne of thy glory.
For break not thy covenant with us, the phrase is broken up between the parts, and keep your ear open for this tenor note at the end. That cadence ought just to sound. But Purcell likes a little bit of harmonic ambiguity, or filth, as we call it in the trade, and plays. Fortunately, it's just passing filth, so that's allowed. Interesting that it sounds dirtier than previous major-minor moments in the piece, because they all kept the major chord in the bottom while allowing the minor chord in the top. And that follows the natural layout of the harmonic series, so that's okay. Major chord, minor chord, and even if you transpose the top one down an octave, it still feels okay. Whereas this way round, minor, major chord, is the opposite to that, feels really quite rough. Though, as we said before, it's a colour occasionally dipped into by Purcell's forebear Thomas Tallis. That was...
Or Gombert.
And Gombert. It's a sort of harmonic colour you can get away with if you're Purcell. If a student had done it, there would have been a red pen out and tears. The final solo section ends with a question. The way to ask a question in music is to start on the key note and to move to the dominant. Have you bought your tickets for life from London? answer back on the tonic. Yes. But Purcell doesn't do that. He moves from chord 5 and answers it with chord 3. So movement from 3 steps, chord 5 to chord 3. What do we call that?
It's tertiary shift!
Coordination!
Dominant 7th?
Is the wrong answer! The correct answer is tertiary shift!
The piece ends with a short triple time chorus, and you'd be forgiven for sauntering off in a jolly sort of dance step. But we wouldn't want to miss one more bit of plangent harmony. What's going on here? Well, two things. Firstly, the basic harmony on Will We Wait Upon Thee is A flat, F minor, G major, and C. You can hear this specifically in the second soprano, the tenor and bass. But the soprano and alto have a different idea and sing it in sixths. And the moment that these two perfectly consonant chord progressions meet and don't agree, we hear a sweet dissonance. Chords. That's the opening of Kate Bush's Wuthering Heights, isn't it? Specially recorded performance coming up, but a few things for you first, and do keep your finger near the pause button in case you want to make a note of any of them. I mentioned Purcell being organist from Westminster Abbey from 1679. The same choir that would have been singing for him, obviously a few changes of personnel between now and then, has been singing ever since, and it's just been announced that they're going to be taking part with their annual Christmas concert in that building where Purcell is buried, as part of the Live from London Christmas Festival. So if you've never made it to the Abbey to hear them sing, now is your chance. Along with the Talis Scholars, Gabrielli consort and players in Bach, hosts of youth groups, Take Six, and indeed Yves Agilini performing Charpentier and ravishing howls on Christmas Eve. If you've not already got a ticket, even more reason to sign up for this wonderful series at yvesagilini.com/Christmas. We also mentioned last time that the Purcell concert at Stour Music, from which was taken the last two performances for Sing the Score, is now available to rent or buy the whole concert. Just go to polyphonicfilms.com/shop, where you'll find that, and indeed interesting projects Yves Agilini have done in the past. Finally, a gentle reminder that while we're not going to put these episodes behind a paywall, they do require donations to keep them going, so a little trip across to yvesagilini.com/friends, and feel free to donate for several episodes at a time, as that makes life easier for our treasurer, who's called Simon. All those links are also in the info underneath the YouTube screen that you're looking at now. Thanks for watching. Here's Greg with The Warning.
Dude, seriously. Be careful when it gets to all those dirty chords, because if you want them to sound really good, you have to aim the wrong way. In other words, keep your flats a tiny bit higher and your sharps a bit lower than you might be used to. Then it should ring like a bell. Okay.
Let mine eyes run down with tears night and day.
Let mine eyes run down.
Let them not sing
night and day.
And let them not sing.
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 a song.
And if I enter into the city, then behold,